All right, welcome everyone to the Phillips Manor Hall State Historic Site History Lecture Series, sponsored in part by the Friends of Phillips Manor Hall. Our guest tonight is Andrea Mosterman, who is Associate Professor in Atlantic History and the Joseph Tregle Professor in Early American History at the University of New Orleans, which is where she's joining us from tonight. Her recent book, Spaces of Enslavement, A History of Slavery and Resistance in Dutch New York, was published with Cornell University Press in 2021, and she's currently researching the voyage of the Dutch slave ship, the Gideon, and the 17th century Dutch Atlantic slave trade with North America, which, of course, those of you who have visited Phillips Manor Hall State Historic Site, that is right up our alley. So, Andrea, I hope when your new book is published, we can have you back again. So I'm going to turn it over to you. Welcome, Andrea, and we're really looking forward to your talk tonight.
Thank you so much, Sarah. Thank you so much for having me, and thank you all for joining us. I look forward to sharing my research with you. I'm going to share my screen, so just give me a second. I hope it's visible to everybody.
Yes, we can see it.
Awesome. Okay, great. So I will be talking about the spaces of enslavement and resistance in Dutch New York. And this is this talk is in large part based on my book, in which I look at various ways in which Dutch New Yorkers used the various spaces to control and monitor enslaved people, and the ways in which enslaved people in return responded to that and resisted within those spaces, and how they use those spaces to resist. For the book, I focus on, for the 17th century, I look at mostly New Amsterdam, so New York City, and then for the 18th and early 19th century, I focus on Ulster County and Albany County and Kings County. But for this talk, I've included a little bit on Westchester County, and I've visited sites in other counties, and I think a lot of the things that I talk about really could be seen across the board. I chose those particular counties because they were heavily Dutch, as in a lot of Dutch descendants and culturally Dutch for a very long time. And, you know, when you study 200 years of slavery in a region as large as New Netherland and later on New York, it's it was one way to kind of limit the research. So I look forward to hearing your questions at the end. So please feel free to ask me whatever I'm not talking about today. But during this talk, I will focus on the 18th and early 19th century, so not really the Dutch colonial period. I'd be happy to talk about that during the Q&A. And I will focus on three particular spaces of enslavement that I've researched. And those spaces are the public space, the home, and the church. So I'll start with the public space, and then I'll talk a little bit about the home. And toward the end, I'll look more closely at the church, and in particular, the Dutch Reformed Church. But before I do so, I want to kind of talk more general about what really are we talking about when we look at slavery in New York, and in particular, the numbers I think are always useful to be able to have some sense of the enslaved population in New York. There are a few censuses that are especially useful, and this is one of them, the 1755 census of slaves, which, as you can see, this is one part of it, a printed copy of that census. It lists not just the enslaver, but also the names of the people that these various people enslaved, and whether they were male or female. It also, it's also important to note that these were adults enslaved people only. So it actually excluded children, anyone below 14 years old. So you can see, for example, if you look on the left top side where it actually says a list of Negro slaves in the manor of Phillipsburg, in the upper part where William Hammond is captain. You can see, for example, that Josiah Martin Esquire enslaved Caesar, Tom, Argyle, Oxford, and Jeffrey. Those were the men, and a woman named Mally. And then if you go down the next one, John Hitchcock, he enslaved a man named Harry and a female named Abigail. I believe these are two, Abigail and Lou. But there are some, like John Sharp is one of the enslaved males who actually has a last name as well there. So a very useful document, not just in kind of getting a sense of who were the various people who enslaved people in New York around this time period, but also actually providing the names of the enslaved people, which are oftentimes very difficult to come by. Now, the 1790 census gives us the most complete information on slavery in New York, and that's why I really like using that census and kind of giving some sense of the population. It also is at the peak of slavery in New York. 1790 is when it peaks, and then it goes down again, in large part, of course, because of the gradual emancipation. Now, you can see here the percentage of the enslaved population per New York County. So this gives an indication of what percentage of the population was enslaved per county as they were in 1790. So not the New York counties of today, but the New York counties as they looked like in 1790. And you can see here that in most cases, the enslaved population was below 10% of the population, but there are some exceptions to that. In particular, Queens, Richmond, and Kings County, which had a very large enslaved population, there it was 31% of the total population. Now, Westchester, as you can see across the board, then it would have had 5.9% according to the 1790 census. When zooming in on Westchester, you can see what the different townships, what the percentage of the population, what percentage of the population there was enslaved. And so here you can see that in many cases it was below 10% per township, but there are again some outliers. Morrisania in particular is very interesting that it is 60% of the population. I will say there were very few people living there at the time. And with Lewis Morris having, I believe he enslaved 17 people at the time of the census. So that really increased the numbers for that particular town. In most cases, it was 10% or below. And if we look at Yonkers, I actually cannot see Yonkers because my face is like, my video is topping it. There it is. It's a little over 10%, right? Like I think 12 to 13% or so. So this just gives us a little bit of an idea. What are we talking about? What are we looking at? And I'll actually give a few more examples from the census in a bit when we're looking at the home space. Now, in the latter part of the 17th century and over the course of the 18th century, we see that slavery expands in the region. And as a part of that, it's necessary to increasingly control and limit the movements of enslaved people in public spaces. And this is in part to really control them, to be able to monitor enslaved people. And this, of course, is in large part to try to avoid any resistance or activities that are not allowed. And so we see by the latter part of the 17th century that the first ordinance is passed that doesn't allow enslaved people to move from point A to B unless they have permission from their enslavers. Subsequently, there are various other laws passed that limit the movements and activities of enslaved people. So enslaved people are no longer, at some point, they're no longer allowed to purchase alcohol. They're no longer allowed to sell goods unless they have permission from their enslavers. They're not allowed to gather in groups larger than three, or in some cases, four people. So there's various limitations on their movements and their activities in the public spaces. So in the streets, in the markets, anywhere in these public spaces in New York, the movements and activities of enslaved people are always controlled and contained. And there were patrols and watchmen and pass systems that were used to enforce such legislation in these public spaces. So many of the cities would have watchmen who would patrol the streets, not just to control and save people, also to look for other things. But controlling the enslaved population was definitely one of the things that they were doing. There were patrols to specifically look out for enslaved people who might be breaking any laws. And of course, the pass system were a big part of that, where enslaved or really any Black person could be asked to prove that they had a pass to legitimize their movements within these spaces. So one of those patrols we can see was organized in the Shangong area in 1796. The Society of Apprenticing Slaves was organized there, and that society was particularly, as the name already indicates, right, was particularly organized to watch out for any enslaved people who tried to flee their enslavers. So this society would have like this record of every enslaver would basically pay a due and record the people that they wanted to be included, that if any of those people would run away, then they would have these writers that would go out and look for them. Now you can see here, and this is an excerpt of one of those papers of the Society of Apprenticing Slaves, that it actually stated, and I quote now, "Resolved that every writer or any other person who shall detect and bring back to his master any runaway slave or slaves shall be entitled to receive from the society the sum of $15 for every such runaway slave and also all reasonable expenses." Now, what's important here is that it's these writers that get paid to retrieve any enslaved person that tries to flee, but also any other free white person could basically stop a Black person to demand to see their paperwork to make sure that they were actually not running away. And if they were indeed an enslaved person who tried to self-liberate, then they could get $15 as an award. And this is really creating this society in which Black people really always had to prove their legitimacy in these spaces, and white people could always demand that proof. Now, Sylvia Du Bois talks about this past system and the circumstance of those. And Sylvia Du Bois was born in New Jersey in slavery. She actually lived part of her life in Pennsylvania in slavery. So this is not necessarily discussing the New York in particular, but I believe that it's useful nevertheless because of the context and her history and these areas all having very similar legislation when it comes to this. And so she says about this, and I'm quoting her now, "You see that in those days, the Negroes were all slaves, and they were sent nowhere nor allowed to go anywhere without a pass. And when anyone met a Negro who was not with his master, he had a right to demand of him whose Negro he was. And if the Negro did not show his pass or did not give good evidence whose he was arrested at once and kept until his master came for him. You see, in those days, anybody had authority to arrest vagrant Negroes. They got paid for arresting them and charges for their keeping till their master redeemed them." Again, it really illustrates, right, how there were these past systems and that really anybody who was white could enforce that and could demand to see these passes and could basically make money even by arresting and returning any person who run away would run away. Now, the control of these public spaces is also evident in the records of the Albany fire. So in Albany in 1793, the night of November 17th, a fire was started in the barn of Hans of Ward. And this caused a large area of Albany to actually burn down. It was a really devastating fire. And three enslaved people were arrested and charged with being responsible for this fire. And one of them, Bet, actually testified and admitted to having done this. Now, I always want to kind of be careful with testimonies like that. We never know if they were real or coerced. It could very well also have been that she testified and admitted guilt because she hoped that that would actually help her save her life. But it didn't. All three of them were actually eventually executed. What's interesting about the testimony, though, is that it gives us it gives us an indication of how she and Dion and Pompey moved through the city, how enslaved people in Albany moved through the city, and also how their movements were controlled. So she actually mentions how the watchmen of Albany were patrolling the cities to, make sure that nothing illegitimate was going on, and that she had timed her movement to set fire to this barn, that she had timed her movement waiting for these watchmen. They were also gathering in a kitchen where they believed that nobody would see them. So they kind of believed that this particular kitchen was a safe place to meet. They then moved through the city via alleyways, and it really kind of describes how they could do so without being seen. And this is one example of the ways in which enslaved people, so even though in these public spaces, their movements were always controlled and surveilled, we see that they are creating these alternative ways of knowing and navigating those spaces. So they're not traveling via the main roads, but they're rather going via alleyways or back roads. They actually would move from backyard to backyard. There's a record that shows that they actually would do selling and buying in outhouses. So they found these different ways to actually still engage in activities that they were not allowed to engage in by using this city or using these spaces in a different way in rural areas. It's similarly, they would have similarly created alternative ways of kind of navigating those spaces to remain unseen or largely unseen. And so that is also the case with Bet, Dion, and Pompey, who are moving through that city in a very calculated way to avoid being found out. Now, like I said, they actually were executed, and they were executed on the same hill that was also the space of the Pinkster celebration in Albany, New York. On this map, you can see the area, and actually my mouse is not working. It doesn't show. I can't. Oh, I can. Here. I think you can see this. So it's this area, right? So this is where today the Capitol is. That was at the time referred to as Pinkster Hill. That was also where the gallows were and where the prison eventually in that same area would be located. The Pinkster celebration in Albany is the most famous one, and it stands out. Pinkster stands out when we think about how much the activities and movements of enslaved people were controlled in these public spaces, because while they're not allowed usually to sell and purchase goods, they're not allowed to drink alcohol or gather in large groups, during the Pinkster celebration, they were allowed to do all of those things. So Pinkster, of course, based on the Dutch holiday, at the Pentecost holiday or Whitsuntide, it was traditionally then this Dutch American celebration, but over time it became increasingly celebrated by enslaved and free Africans and African Americans in New York, and we have records from it being celebrated in Brooklyn and Albany and various other places in between. Sojourner Truth talks about Pinkster as a very important holiday to be able to gather with family, and you can imagine that in a lot of these areas where very few people would be enslaved by one particular family, the few opportunities you would have to really meet with family and friends, especially in larger groups, really Pinkster was the only moment to be able to do that. So it became this really big celebration, and you can see here an excerpt from the Pinkster Ode, which is one of the documents that we have about Pinkster, and this one is from 1803. And I'm going to just read the excerpt 2, it's on the left here. It says, all beneath the shady tree, there they hold the jubilee. Charles the king will then advance, leading on the guinea dance. Moving over the flowery green, you'll know him by his graceful mien. You'll know him on the dancing ground, for where he is, folks gather round. You know him by his royal nose, you'll know him by his pinkster clothes, you'll know him by his pleasant face and by his hat or yellow lace. You'll know him by his princely air and his politeness to the fair. And when you know him, then you'll see a slave whose soul was always free. Look till the visual nerves do pain, you'll never see his likes again. So Charles, obviously King Charles, who was the head of the Pinkster celebration in Albany, or King Charlie, he's sometimes referred to, was very prominent in the celebration. He would lead a parade of the down the streets of Albany. They would gather on the Pinkster Hill and celebrate for days. Many, many people coming from all over the area together, mostly Black people, but there were also white people who were there, either observing, sometimes maybe marginally participating. And so it stands out in this public space that this particular holiday was allowed, and it became a very important moment then for people to meet with family and friends, but also to celebrate African and African American religious and cultural practices. Now, one of the things that I think is important that we keep in mind is that even though this was then this large African-American festival, it still was very much controlled by the white population. It was, as I noted, taking place on Pinkster Hill, which was also the place where the gallows were. So there's this very physical kind of sometimes referred to as architectures of violence, like this physical reminder that yes, you are allowed to celebrate during these few days, but if you go beyond any of the things that you are allowed to do, this is what might happen to you. You might be executed. So the location of it, the kind of the architecture around that particular space to remind enslaved people of what would happen if they did not abide by the regulations, and also the fact that white people were very much present, mostly observing though, and kind of in that sense, observing and controlling the population, also enjoying kind of the display of African Americans celebrating. And this is not particular to New York. We see similar types of circumstances and celebrations in every other place in what is now the United States. So again, it still even fits in within that context of kind of thinking about how enslavers in Dutch New York were using these public spaces to control and surveil enslaved people. It also is a way to then, you know, have people have this moment of opportunity where they would be able to get some relief from their enslavement. And one of the things that enslavers oftentimes believed is that that would then also allow for, they would be more able to sustain the system of slavery by kind of having these few days where enslaved people could feel like they were free. And that's how Sojourner Truth actually talked about it, as feeling freedom for a few days. Now, I want to move to enslavement in the home. And here I just briefly want to start with, again, going back to that census and showing you some of the data to better understand like the context of what we're looking at. And remember that the enslaved population in most of this area, I believe it was around 10% in most areas of Westchester and, of course, in New York more broadly. When we look at the enslavement of people within the home, the percentages change. And I think it's important to think about that. So you can see here the percentages of households that enslaved people within their homes or on their grounds. And in most of these cases, and I didn't do all of the townships of Westchester because it's just too many, and doesn't really, it wasn't, I don't think it was especially useful, but I just chose randomly a few of them, and almost all of them, a third or over a third of the households would have enslaved people in the home. Mount Pleasant is the outlier, interestingly, with just over 10%. So in most of those cases, every one in three households would enslave people within their homes. And I highlighted on the left Yonkers, which came at 33.5%, and Westchester, the township, which came at 36.5%. So what then did that look like when we think about enslaved people living in the homes of their enslavers or on the grounds? And what does it look like in the context of New York? We oftentimes, when we think about slavery, we tend to think about large plantations and that have slave cabins where enslaved people live. But of course, in New York, it was a very different circumstance. And this is one of the things that I really that I really investigated and kind of not just taking the records for what they were, but actually visiting the spaces that supposedly enslaved people in New York lived in, and really kind of tried to imagine what those spaces looked like, what they would have smelled like, felt like, and how enslaved people might have navigated those spaces. So here you can see the Lot House, which on the left, which is the house of the Lot family. It was first built in the 1730s, and actually it was this structure that was built in the 1730s. The part here was added in the early 19th century, so I'm not talking about that. So this structure was a one-room space with an attic, and not long after that was built, this lean-to was added, which had the kitchen in it. Now, it really wasn't until a few decades ago that a groundskeeper, I believe it was, found that actually in this lean-to, there was a closet. The closet is still there, but when you open the closet, what the groundskeeper discovered is that you could move the ceiling and actually open it and pull down a stairwell that led to this stairs and a doorway that would bring you to this attic where the Lot family likely slept. And on both sides of that little stairwell were garret spaces that archaeologists were researching. After that, they started researching those spaces, and they found evidence that people had actually lived in those spaces. Some of that evidence was candle wax. There was a beehive style oven in this space, in the chimney here. And there were actually various items placed underneath the floorboard right there. Now, the pictures that you see here were taken by a professional photographer, so you can, that there's good lighting, so you can see those spaces really well. I visited these spaces, and when I did so, I just brought, I had my phone and I did take a picture, but even those pictures are really dark. And it really was because there's no natural light in those spaces, none whatsoever. They're very small. You would not be able to stand up in them. They are they would have been very hot in the summer, potentially cold in the winter, especially the garret space on the right, because that did not have a chimney going through it, so it wouldn't have any opportunities to warm up that space. And several people likely lived in these garret spaces at the Lot House. By the latter part of the 18th century, the Lot family who lived in this home enslaved, and you can see their names here. They enslaved Mary, Hannah, Mel, Kate, Harry, Hector, Powell, and the children Cyrus, Jan, Jacob, Hannah, and Paul. So all of those people likely stayed in these very small spaces. And one other thing to just note is that there also was a lock on the outside of these garret spaces. Archaeologists don't know what those locks were used for, but it does stand out that there were locks on the outside of the room, not the inside. So many enslaved people in New York would have slept in garret spaces, very likely similar to the ones at the Lotts House. But we also know that a lot of enslaved people lived in basements or cellars, as they're usually more commonly referred to in the New York context. And this was, I believe, the case at Schuyler Mansion. There are some suggestions that enslaved people lived in the attic. It's possible that a few of them would have stayed in the attic, but there are some records that actually refer to them having stayed in the cellar of the mansion. And architecturally, it also makes more sense, to me at least. When you look at the house, so you can see this is the back of the Schuyler Mansion. And there was an entryway into the cellar on the back side here. And that entryway actually did not go straight into the mansion. It would go into this walled courtyard. So there was no way for the enslaved people who were in that cellar to actually be able to access the home directly. They would have to go via that courtyard. Now, there was an outdoor kitchen. The cellar did not have a kitchen, as usually homes did have. So for example, the Tenbrook Mansion, they believed that it did have a kitchen in the cellar. And also that the enslaved people lived in the cellar. But in the case of Schuyler Mansion, the kitchen was right here and in this walled courtyard. And so enslaved people lived in the cellar and would have exited and entered that via that walled courtyard, which could be viewed from the windows at the back. So there's really kind of this idea of the panopticon where you'd never know if you were being watched, but anybody in the Schuyler family could watch you from those windows, which were actually located at the large stairwell in the Schuyler Mansion. So it was a way to really control and be able to surveil the enslaved people who lived at the mansion, especially those people who were mostly working in and around the house. The other thing important here to really think about is that oftentimes when it's talked about in the context of New York, this idea that enslaved people lived in the homes of their enslavers, there's this assumption that somehow that meant that they were living in the same spaces, or that slavery was not so bad because they were living in the same house where their enslavers lived. But of course, they did not live in the same parts of the home. And I think that that is very important that we constantly remind ourselves of that. So when you go to Schuyler Mansion and you walk in through the front door, you'll see like this beautiful large hallway, high ceilings, lots of natural white tall windows, like I said, this large stairwell, a really, really beautiful space, many different rooms. Those spaces, the enslaved people at Schuyler mentioned, very rarely would have actually accessed those spaces. They would have been in the cellar, in that walled courtyard, unless they had some business in the main house. They would not have spent a lot of time there. And that would, of course, been the same with the Lott family, that they were living in the same structure, but they were residing in very different parts of that space, and they would have navigated those spaces very differently. And this is where Sojourner Truth's narrative actually tells us a little bit about her experiences in a cellar, which was of the in Ulster County. And she tells us about her experiences in the cellar where she grew up. And she actually writes, "Its only lights consisted of a few panes of glass through which she thinks the sun never shone, but with thrice reflected rays. And the space between the loose boards of the floor and the uneven earth below was often filled with mud and water." So this was her experience growing up in a basement in or a cellar in New York. And that does not mean that all cellars look the same, but it's very likely that many of them were very similar experiences for the enslaved people who lived in them. So very different from other parts of the home where the family, the free white family would have lived. Now, going back to the Lot House, one of the things we also see there, and I pointed it out briefly earlier, but is the ways in which people resisted in those spaces. And again, you can see here these corn cobs that were hidden below the floorboard. So enslaved people actually very likely hid those corn cobs, the enslaved people who were at the Lot House. They also, and this is now on display at the Museum of the City of New York, and so the picture's not as clear as I would love, but these are the corn cobs. They also found below that floorboard a cloth pouch, which is here, with an oyster shell and a goat pelvis. They also found a child's shoe, which actually was a common practice in a lot of New York homes to safeguard the spaces. A shoe would be placed in below floorboards or in between walls. Now, the cloth pouch that they found there is very similar to cages or cachets that can be found in other parts of the African diaspora and in Atlantic Africa. Places like West Central Africa, where these were common, the Senegambia area, where their such pouches are oftentimes referred to as grigri. These were oftentimes pouches that were either worn on the body to keep somebody safe or to protect or give strength, or they're buried in the floor, usually in earth. But if there's no earth accessible, then we see them under floorboards, as was the case here. And so it's an indication of how the people who lived in those garret spaces may have used those items to protect themselves within those spaces and to create some sense of security within those spaces, even though they had very few opportunities to really protect themselves. This was one way of doing so. And this is particularly likely because they were placed oftentimes close to openings like the chimney and the doorway, which the placement of it further on suggests that it was there to safeguard the space, as was the corn cobs, which were placed in a cross or a star, both which are symbols that are very important symbols in African religious practices, various African religious practices to safeguard spaces. So we see how enslaved people are finding ways to protect the spaces that they were living in. We also see them basically escaping those spaces. And that's another important thing to think about when we think about the home space and the meaning of that space. Whereas on the one hand, for free white New Yorkers, these homes might have symbolized family, domesticity, safety, security. For a lot of enslaved people, these were spaces of enslavement. They were spaces of forced labor, of abuse, of sometimes separation of family. A lot of enslaved people would be bought and sold and moved from home to home, living with various different people. It would have been very difficult to establish long-lasting relationships with other enslaved people in those spaces. And so in many cases, what we see happening is that enslaved people were actually trying to flee those homes, and in some case, fleeing those homes to actually be with family, rather. Here is one from Phillipsburg, and one of these advertisements that were placed in the colonial and early Republic newspapers that were really, really common in New York newspapers. I've you know, almost every time you pick up a newspaper from these time periods, you'll find at least one of these advertisements. And this one was for Bill, who had escaped Dennis Hicks of Phillipsburg in West Chester County. And there's a long description of him. It's a very interesting description because he says that he, according to this advertisement, that he had a white mother, that he was born in New England. He actually had been captured at some point, but he was able to flee again to escape the prison where he was held. So a very interesting description. And this is just one of the many, many, many advertisements similar to this ones, these ads that were looking for people that tried to flee the homes in which they were enslaved. Here's another one, which was published in the Albany Register on August 1st, 1813, so much later than the one you previously saw. And here it actually is evident how relationships between people play an important role in them running away. This is a woman named Fan, who, let me just read it, aged 30 years, 5 feet 8 or 9 inches high, stout built, took with an infant female of 9 months old named Diana. So this woman took a baby of 9 months old. It says that she asked permission to visit her children in Schoharie County, which was granted her, but she took this method to the better to succeed in her elopement. So here she took advantage of a pass, a permission to travel to her family, to actually run away with one of her children. And it says, whoever will apprehend said runaway and secure her in any gold estate shall be entitled to $10 reward. This particular woman had been heard of in Hudson, Aesopus, and lastly in Poughkeepsie. So you can see here how people were sometimes fleeing to be with family, sometimes fleeing to stay with their family members. And this is actually in a lot of these advertisements clear how people are trying to reunite with family or looking for family, fleeing the homes in which they are enslaved to be with their loved ones. And this fact that enslaved people were oftentimes separated from family members in New York and very rarely lived with family members or all of their family members is really evident when you look through the records. There are so many bills of sales of various people, but also oftentimes of children, wills that divide up enslaved families where certain children, sometimes children that are not even born yet, that are bequeathed to a daughter and another one to a son. And this was something that was always present for enslaved people, the opportunity, that the chance that this would happen to them and their family. So in the rare cases that they lived with family members, there was also always the understanding that these people that they loved could be separated from them at any moment. And that is described so well by Sojourner Truth when she discusses her the moment that her enslaver, Charles Hardenberg, passes away. She at that point lives with her father, mother, and brother. She had several siblings who already had been sold away in previous years. So only Sojourner and her brother were still remained with their parents. And when their enslaver passed away, Sojourner Truth describes how her mother responded to those moments. And so I'm going to read this to you. It's in the third person because Sojourner Truth narrates this to the person who wrote it down. And she is referred to here still as Isabella. Isabella Bomfrey was the name she still had when she was a child. She later on, of course, changed this to Sojourner Truth. So she writes, or she narrated, after this event, she was often surprised to find her mother in tears. And so again, the event is the passing away of Charles Hardenberg. And when, in her simplicity, she inquired, "Mama, what makes you cry?" She would answer, "Oh, my child, I'm thinking of your brothers and sisters that have been sold away from me." And she would proceed to detail many circumstances respecting them. But Isabella long since concluded that it was the impending fate of her only remaining children, which her mother bit too well understood even then, that called upon those memories from the past and made them crucify her heart afresh. This passage always gets me. As a mother of young children, Sojourner Truth at that moment was 8 years old. And what her mother is describing here is that, or what Sojourner Truth is describing here is that her mother, she now later on in life understood that her mother in this moment very well knew that with the death of their enslaver, the last two children she still had by her side would soon be sold away from her. And this did indeed happen not long after Sojourner Truth and her brother were sold at the auction block. Again, Sojourner was only 8 years old at the time. So You know, whatever the circumstances were, this was always a possibility. This could always happen. And every family understood that this was possible, that they could be ripped away from the people that they loved at any moment. Now, lastly, I want to move on to the church. So I've talked about the public space, I've talked about the home space, and I'll now look at the church as the final space of enslavement. And here I look at the Dutch Reformed Church mostly so as a space of social power. So I'm focusing less on the theology of it, but more so on the importance, the important role the church had in also belonging and being part of the community and being able to improve your circumstances within a community. And here it's important to just note that in the 17th century, there are a lot of enslaved people that actually are marrying and baptizing their children in the Dutch Reformed Church of New Amsterdam. These opportunities quickly reduced by the latter part of the 17th century. And the reason why these enslaved people married and baptized, had their children baptized in the church, was very likely religious. Like many of these people were from West Central Africa. They likely were Christians, Catholic, before they came to North America. So there must have been, religious reasons, the Dutch Reformed Church being the only accepted denomination in the colony at the time. So there must have been religious reasons for them to join the church, but also they clearly understood that being part of the Dutch Reformed Church also gained the added to their status in the community and gave them opportunities to move upward. And that is one of the reasons why we increasingly see hesitation amongst enslaver to actually accept enslaved people within the church. They worried that these enslaved people might use their participation in the church or membership even to fight for their freedom, to argue that they should be free. And so this is one of the reasons likely when we see fewer and fewer people who are actually enslaved, free and enslaved, but mostly enslaved Black people who are admitted in Dutch Reformed churches in the 18th century. There are some exceptions, and one exception is Rachel. And this particular exception actually shows that there was some hesitation here with a worry that maybe, accepting her in the church could cause her to petition for her freedom in some way. So there's actually an annotation. You can see the document on the left, the church record of the Kingston Church records. And on the right, I've translated parts of it. So this is from September 5th, 1703, and it says that Rachel promised as part of her confession and acceptance as a full member in that church, quote, that she shall serve her mistress, Catherine Cotain, loyally and humbly until Catherine's death, after which she would serve young Cotain for 8 more months before she would become free. So clearly here they want to make sure that it's clear to Rachel and that that there is a record of this, that this does not mean that she will get her freedom, at least not as long as Catherine or Catherine is still alive. Now we also see the hesitation of accepting enslaved people in the church in a letter that Reverend Peter Lowe wrote, and he was a Dutch Reformed minister in the six congregations of Kings County. He was the one who was doing the English language services. Reverend Schoonmaker was the one who was doing the Dutch services. And he is actually one of the very first people who was educated in New York, who got his church education, his religious education in New York. He studied with Livingston. And when he was minister in this church in November of 1788, he describes how this group of Black people asked to become members in the church, and he wants to admit them. but his congregants opposed to allowing Black people in the church. And some of the things they noted, he wrote down like their 10 main objections and his own rebuttal, because he did not agree with any of these objections. One of these objections was that they had no soul. I put number three there, that they were accursed of God. Another objection was, and I quote, they are a species very different from us. Witness their nauseous sweat, complexion, manners, etc. I cannot endure them near me. I would be ashamed to commune with them. And finally, objection eight, if many of them would be admitted, I tremble for the ark, I enjoy order and harmony in the Dutch church, see the absurd consequences. They will at length summon their masters before the consistory, nay, constitute a consistory themselves. What an awful sight. Negro elders, deacons, church masters, etc. The document, all the different objections really show how, yes, there are some religious arguments they make. They actually say that they're descendants of Ham or Canaan, a very common kind of explanation. But many of them are also more social and more about sharing the space, or the fear that it would threaten the hierarchy of their communities is very clear in objection number eight. And of course, the sharing of the space in objection number four. And this is where I briefly want to move to kind of thinking about the church space and what it looked like. This is the First Church of Albany, which shows you kind of what a lot of the early Dutch Reformed churches in the colony would have looked like. These square buildings with a belfry in the center of it. The pulpit would be elevated, and they would have these galleries. And the galleries actually were usually the most premier seating because they were closest to the pulpit. And so this is where the men would be seated. The older men would be seated below. And the women and children would be here. And this, one of the things important here is that there is a really also a sense of surveillance in these churches, that the elders and deacons, they oftentimes were sitting, and this continues on the sides where they really can watch not just the minister, but also the congregation. And also the idea that the elevated spaces were there for the men, and that men and women were segregated. All of this is common in churches, in Dutch Reformed churches in New York. Over time, this changes, and there are a few churches left that actually show those churches in the structure, those changes in the structure. One of them is the Fishkill Church of Dutchess County. This is an image of the church, and this is a plan of the church, and you can see here that initially this was the entrance, and it was a more square building similar to the First Church in Albany. Then at the latter part of the 18th century, it was turned into a more like rectangle type of shape with a bell tower that was placed by the entrance of the church. And so you would come in at the entrance, and then the pulpit was lowered and placed opposite to the bell tower and the entrance. And the galleries were lowered and into two balconies that were still, you know, they were still balconies, but they oftentimes were lower than the galleries had been. And we can see similar, this is the interior of the Fishkill Church, where you actually can see still here what originally had been the entrance of the church, and then the pulpit would have been across from that. And here's the Reformed Church of Shangunk, another one of these older churches where you can see this. Here was the entrance originally on the what's now the side of the building. And now, of course, in the same way, there's this bell tower in the front with the entrances. And entrances to the balconies actually are on the sides here. So people who are going into the balcony don't even have to go through the same door as the people who are going into the church on the first floor. The New Paltz Church was built in 1839, so actually a little bit outside of this period. It does have the similar architectural style, as you can see. And it also, what is interesting about this church is that we actually have the plans of where people were seated. So in the older churches, like the First Church of Albany, enslaved people, those few enslaved people who would be in the church, either to assist their enslavers or maybe to worship themselves, would oftentimes be located in like in between spaces, either in a pew with their enslavers or standing in the aisles or in the back or sometimes even outside. Over the course of the 17th century, by the latter part of the 18th, early 19th century, we see that more Black people are joining these churches, are accepted in these churches, and this is in large part because of the Second Great Awakening. And that also meant that they more often had designated spaces in these churches. So when we look at the New Paltz Church, we can see those designated spaces were on the second floor in the back here. It says colored men and colored females. Now, again, this is after the abolition of slavery, but we see similar layouts in other churches as well, even during the era of slavery. And this is an image of the seat where these people would have been seated. And here, this is a picture of the Albany Church, the later church, the one still standing today. It's taken kind of from the location where the enslaved people were seated in this church. And as you can see on the left, there are very much these discussions of where can free and enslaved Black people be located, be seated in this church. Daniel Winna in 1815 actually informed the treasury that he would pay for his pew only, I quote, provided the consistory will remove the Blacks from behind his pew, as was understood. So there very much is this opposition to having Black people close in these spaces to the white congregants. And we don't have any records of how enslaved people in New York experienced this, but we do have some from New England churches. William Brown, for example, writes that many attended no church at all because they said they were opposed to going to churches and sitting in pigeonholes, as all the churches at that time at some obscure place for the colored to sit in. Similarly, Cato Pierce talks about this, saying that, and the gentleman I worked for went and showed me the box for the colored people. I pretty soon found out it was a Presbyterian church. I was so far off from the minister, and he preached by note that I couldn't understand hardly anything he said. And this is very common in many of these accounts, that for the people who were segregated in these churches, placed in these back benches, sometimes on the first floor or oftentimes on the balcony, that they really felt that this was humiliating. They oftentimes could not hear or see what was going on. And so it also actually dissuaded a lot of them from even joining these churches, these congregations. And it's not just the spatial segregation in these churches, but also a temporal segregation where they actually would not be allowed to commune at the same time, but had to wait for white congregants to commune before Black congregants would be able to do so. And this is described, for example, by Frederick Douglass. Again, not a description from an experience in New York, but a very similar circumstance. He describes it in the case of New England. And he actually will talk about it. And I'm just going to read that first sentence to you. I was anxious to observe the bearing of colored members, and the result was most humiliating. And that comes out in all of these different documents. Now, lastly, and I know it's time, so I'm going to wrap this up. James Murphy was formerly enslaved Black New Yorker who went to the seminary in New Brunswick and became an ordained minister at the Clove, Warsing, and Rochester churches. He did not tell the congregation that he was, in fact, a formerly enslaved and Black man. And when we look kind of at the ways in which enslaved and free Black people were treated in these Dutch Reformed churches, it's not surprising that he would not have shared that information. Black people were not even allowed to sit in many cases in the main parts of the church. So for somebody to try to be a minister and actually preach to his congregation from an elevated pulpit, even on a very physical architectural level, would have been completely unacceptable. And so he, in fact, did not tell his congregation or anybody that he was Black, while his mother was actually from Dutchess County and still alive when he was working in these churches. And when he was found out, there was a lot of opposition from congregants, likely because they gave all kinds of different reasons. And I would be happy to expand in Q&A if anybody's interested. But it's very clear from the records that their objection was likely because they had a hard time accepting a Black man in a position of power in their church. So I already talked about the Lot House, so I'm going to leave it there. I'm not really, it was just a reference to religion, but I already talked about that. So thank you so much. I'm leaving it there, but if you have any questions, please share them. I would be happy to answer them. And I also, like I said, I write about this in much more detail in my book. So if you're interested, it is available, and you can also always email me or follow me on Twitter, and I will stop talking now. Thank you so much. I look forward to your questions.
Yeah, thank you so much, Andrea. That was fascinating. We do have a couple of questions. Two of them are from Michael, so maybe some other folks have questions too. So he's talking about, he says, with Nkisi and other African spiritual practices, the way the objects were placed was very important. Why did MCNY, which I assume is the Museum of Sydney in New York, choose not to place the objects in the manner that they were found? If you know anything
about
that.
That's a good question. I don't know. I will say, I mean, that's a great question. I have no idea why they placed it as they did. I will say that I actually am not 100% sure how they found the items, because I do know that they say that it was disturbed where an archaeologist found it, but still placed in such a way that they believe it was a star or a cross that they can still, you know, say that it was, but they believe that it had already been moved slightly by like rodents. So I don't know if that's part of why it is as it was. I have no idea, but that's a really good question. And you know, maybe one of us can ask them when we have a chance.
And then his next question, as both a public and private space, do you have any information you can share about burial and funeral practices within the enslaved community?
Yeah, I mean, so I do look at this. I talk about it a little bit in my book, but more so in the context of the Dutch Reformed Church and how the burial grounds were also oftentimes kept, you know, and enslaved people were kept out of these burial grounds, oftentimes placed also there in segregated areas and areas that were less wanted pieces of land. So I talk about it more in that context, not so much about the actual burial practices of enslaved people. Although we do, of course, I mean, we don't have that much evidence of it, but there's some evidence, especially from the New York burial ground, in where we can see how, you know, they would still like have certain items that were buried with people, certain placements. So those are some of the things that I do discuss in the book to some extent, but mostly, again, within the context of the Dutch Reformed Church and how even that part was a way to control and save people and to kind of keep them out of that social, like to control them socially.
Kathy says, nice to hear you in person. I really enjoyed your book. Can you explain again about how the garret was discovered at the Brooklyn House?
Yeah, so from what I remember, it was really just, like I said, a groundskeeper who It's very small, so it's not as if you would think about that actually having been a space where people were living or staying. And so it was a groundskeeper who really by accident in this closet, at least that's the story that I was told when I visited, so that they kind of just realized that the ceiling was moving, and that's how they founded it. And that's how they found it, not found it, found it. And so by chance, and that's when they got our archaeologists in who did a lot of work there, and there's a great dissertation on it, and a really interesting article on the archaeology, the work that they did there, the excavation. So if you're interested, let me know and I can share it with you.
Great, I would like that. So if you want to send it to me, I can send it to everybody.
Absolutely.
Linda says, she doesn't have a question really. She says, this is excellent. Thanks ever so much for this wonderful program. And Linda, the recording will be available in the future. We'll probably put it up on our YouTube channel, but probably not till after Pinkster. We'll see. We'll see how the next week goes. Any other questions from folks who are watching? I don't know if you, I sadly have not read your book, and Michael took home our copy of your book, Andrea. So I don't know if you addressed, I'd be interested to know if you talk at all about the role of the church in like the New Netherland period. I know there's some kind of controversy in the early period when they're basically codifying slavery and what that means. So I'd be interested, and if you could just say if it's in the book or not, how the Dutch Reformed Church kind of shifted, doctrine around who is allowed to become a Christian and kind of what that means in the context of slavery.
Yeah, so I actually I do talk about this, and in the 17th century we see, like I said, enslaved people actually participating in these Dutch Reformed churches. There is no change in doctrine in the Dutch Reformed Church, and this is what can be a little bit confusing, but this is where I think it is so important to think about the power of congregations in the Dutch Reformed Church. So a lot of the decision making was actually laid with the congregation, right? And especially the consistory. And so we see that there are some churches that throughout the 18th century do still accept enslaved people, or accept in certain periods enslaved people. And then there are other congregations who don't accept enslaved people at all for a very long time. And what's important to note is that, for example, Kings County, the Low Letter that I shared, which is from 1788, so really, like around the time that the Second Great Awakening is really starting to gain steam, it is also the county where this enslaved population was the largest, right? So where people were benefiting most from the labor of enslaved people. And so I believe that it had largely to do with the particular communities in them, and in this area, and each community made those decisions whether or not they wanted to include enslaved people. And so in a community where people are largely depending on the labor of enslaved people, they might be more resistant to actually accepting those people in the church, worrying that that might challenge the institution of slavery and the hierarchies that are so integral to that. So this is what is interesting. And so going from the Dutch period to the 18th century, the difference really is that more and more individuals are enslaving people, and so more individuals are becoming more invested in like whether or not enslaved people should be allowed in the church. And those are some of the main things that I see happening and changing over time.
Great. Thank you for explaining that, because I was curious. So that's good to know that it wasn't actually specific doctrines, individual congregations. Ellie wants to know, when and how did the Dutch descendants assimilate into English and then American society? And she's talking about both white colonists and enslaved Africans.
So this depends on the county, and the people and the families really. So this is why I don't look at New York City, the Manhattan for the 18th century, because there we more quickly see that it becomes English becomes the dominant language, and in places like Kings County, really up until the early 19th century, Dutch culture and the Dutch language are still very prominent, and the Dutch Reformed Church is still very prominent, and the same with Ulster County. Albany around the time of the revolution. And in most cases, people will say that it's around the time of the revolution that we see in a lot of these areas that rather than identifying as Dutch, people start to identify more as American. And that's when the Dutch language slowly but surely disappears. But like I said, in some areas we see up until the early 19th century that Dutch is still frequently spoken. So for example, Peter Lowe, he corresponds with his mother, Maria Lowe, who lives in Kingston, New York, in Dutch. Sojourner Truth, of course, spoke the Dutch language when she grew up. And that's in the early 19th century, like very latter part of the 18th and the early 19th century. So it's really, and in some cases it continues until even later. So it kind of depends on the region and the people.
Yeah, the Phillips family pretty much considers themselves English with the third generation, Frederick II. Very confusing. He's the third generation, but he's Frederick II. And we think that's in large part because he is educated in England at the behest of his grandfather, Frederick Phillips I. That was like his deathbed wish, supposedly, that his grandson be educated in England. So that's really the start of the transition for that family.
It's
Right.
fascinating.
Any other questions? Give people a second to gather their thoughts. Any last comments from you, Andrew? Anything you left out or forgot about that you want to include quickly?
No, not really, but like I said, like feel free to email me. I can't promise that I'll respond right away, but I do try. I do try, and I do like to hear from people. And if there's any, any questions you have, I always try to get back to people. So please never hesitate to email me.
We did get one more from Kathy. She says, I'm trying to recall, but did enslaved people stay underneath the stairwell?
Stay as in like sleep underneath the stairwell, is that what
I
we're
guess, yeah.
I mean, so in cellars, so that I guess there's an underneath the stairwell in those spaces oftentimes as well. I'm not sure if that answers the question, but yeah, in New York we mostly see that enslaved people lived either in cellars, garret spaces or attics. Sometimes in separate spaces, separate buildings, sometimes like if there's an outdoor kitchen, they might be staying in that. Or in a few cases, there's a few notices where people actually had a property with safe cabins on it, but that was unusual, rare.
And do I remember you talked about some of the spaces had exterior entrances to the basements? I took a tour of the Ellison House, Knox's headquarters, in Fales Gate, I guess is technically the town. It's right by Newburgh. And they said there's now an interior staircase to get into the basement, but that was a 19th century addition, and there had an exterior entrance, and so that kind of blew my mind. I hadn't thought about that. Sorry, my light just turned off.
And that's,
Period.
yeah, no, but that's oftentimes the case actually, that they would have these exterior entrances. Actually, you see the same in Ulster County and a lot of these stone houses that the cellar actually had a separate entrance from the outside. So if you go to historic Huguenot Street, you can see that in some of those homes. And also, when there are stairwells going into the cellar, what is really telling, and you can see this really well at the Dyckman farmhouse, is that the type of stairs is very different from the one in the main house. And sometimes even, what I believe becomes more practice in the 19th century, but the idea of servant stairs. So there would be a stairwell oftentimes in the back of the home that actually is very small and narrow that enslaved or servants would use, but also the cellar into the stairwell into the cellar oftentimes is that same type of quality. So not a type of cellar that you know, you have your guests go down, or that maybe even, you know, if you are the lady of the house, that you would go down on frequently. It really is more for servant or enslaved laborers to use. So the architecture can tell us a lot, and it's really interesting that when you go into those spaces, you can really kind of see things that you wouldn't know if you're just reading documents, and they tell a story in and of themselves.
So Linda has a comment about Frederick Phillips. She says he also knew which side his bread was buttered on, so to speak. The English were now in power, not the Dutch. He became the quintessential English gentleman. Yeah, so Frederick Phillips II is an adult, you know, after the British takeover of the colony. But it's really Frederick Phillips III, the fourth generation, who becomes kind of the quintessential English gentleman, right? And then Jared has, I think this is more a comment, saying Pinkster was celebrated in New York City at the Commons, and the enslaved were tortured and killed there. This is at the bottom of City Hall Park.
Yeah. Yeah, no, and that's exactly the same as Albany, right? So we can see that in New York City as well, that it's very much, it also oftentimes was close to African burial grounds. And that's actually mentioned in the Pinkster Ode as well. So the presence of the ancestors may have played a role there as well. But yes, this idea that there were always these very physical reminders of people's place in society and what would happen if you don't abide by the rules. Those were always very present in the location, in several cases, of the location of the Pinkster celebration. So yeah, in New York City, I know.
That's a really interesting comment that Pinkster celebrations were often near African burial grounds. That makes a lot of sense, but I had not considered that. So. Thank you for being here.
Yeah.
All right. Any other questions? Last call for questions. Oh, Linda's talking more about Fred the Third. Yep. If you want to know more about Frederick the Third, you can come to Phillips Manor Hall and we'll tell you all about it. All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us tonight, Andrea. That was a great talk. Everybody, if you haven't read her book, Spaces of Enslavement, highly recommended. Michael said he's going to bring back our library copy so I can get a chance at it too. So I hope when your new book is published, we can have you back. And everybody on the call, hopefully you will join us and enjoy Pinkster, our Pinkster Festival at Phillips Manor Hall next Saturday, May 20th. So I am going to end the meeting. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much for having me.
Joining us. All right. Have a good night.